Don't think that you're ever free when you're lost in the doubt and you can't see what's around the bend. Just hold on, don't turn around, keep on walking, don't lose heart. 'Cause I am here, wherever you are, whatever you are. Tomorrow, my love, oh, and the rain is falling. There's no silver lining, and you just can't seem to find the light. When you need a reason to help you keep believing, let my love be your blue.
Welcome to worship. We're glad that you've joined us today. Whether this is your first time or you're here week after week, we hope you're blessed by this service. We begin today then in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let us pray. Gracious God, we give you thanks for your word, for your presence among us, for the ways in which you enrich our lives. We ask now that you would come and meet us again now. Open us to your word, guide us by your presence, hold us in your love. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Join me as we confess our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Come, thou font of every blessing, turn my heart and fill thy grace. Streams of mercy never ceasing, calls for song and loudest praise. While the hopes of endless glory fills my heart with joy and love, teach me ever to adore thee, may I still thy goodness prove. Here I raise my Ebenezer, hither by thy help I come, and I hope by good pleasure safely to arrive at home. Jesus sought me when a stranger wandered from the fold of God. He to rescue me from danger interpose his precious blood. Oh, to grace how great a debtor daily I constrain to be. Like the grace now, like a fetter, bind my wandering heart to thee. Prone to wander, Lord, I feel it, prone to leave the God I love. Here's my heart, oh, take and seal it for thy courts above.
Our gospel this morning is from the Gospel of Mark, chapter 6. King Herod heard of it, for Jesus' name had become known. Some were saying, John the Baptizer has been raised from the dead, and for this reason these powers are at work in him. But others said, it is Elijah, and others said, it is a prophet like one of the prophets of old. But when Herod heard of it, he said, John, whom I beheaded, has been raised. For Herod himself had sent men who arrested John, bound him, and put him in prison on account of Herodias, his brother Philip's wife, because Herod had married her. For John had been telling Herod, it is not lawful for you to have your brother's wife. And Herodias had a grudge against him and wanted to kill him. But she could not, for Herod feared John, knowing that he was a righteous and holy man, and he protected him. When he heard him, he was greatly perplexed, and yet he liked to listen to him. But an opportunity came when Herod, on his birthday, gave a banquet for his courtiers and officers and for the leaders of Galilee. When his daughter Herodias came in and danced, she pleased Herod and his guests, and the king said to the girl, ask me for whatever you wish, and I will give it. And he solemnly swore to her, whatever you ask me, I will give you, even half of my kingdom. She went out and said to her mother, what should I ask for? She replied, the head of John the Baptizer. Immediately she rushed back to the king and requested, I want you to give me at once the head of John the Baptist on a platter. The king was deeply grieved, yet out of regard for his oaths and for the guests, he did not want to refuse her. Immediately the king sent a soldier of the guard with orders to bring John's head. He went and beheaded him in the prison, brought his head on a platter, and gave it to the girl. Then the girl gave it to her mother. When his disciples heard about it, they came and took his body and laid it in a tomb. The Gospel of our Lord. I invite you to pray with me. O Lord, we thank you for your word. And we ask that you bring your word into our minds and hearts and thus into our lives and through our lives out into the world, that the world may know your love and your salvation. Amen. Quite often we forget where our cultural sayings come from, and so their true meanings are changed or lost to succeeding generations. For instance, growing up, when I heard the phrase, don't lose your head, it was understood to mean that you had to keep thinking your way through the problem at hand, that you couldn't get too scared or rattled to deal with whatever needed to be dealt with. It makes sense, for another image that we use in English for someone to keep their cool is, don't run around like a chicken with its head cut off. Idioms usually have an origin in good common sense. Yet there's a school of thought that the original sources for the meaning of don't lose your head were from more dire and deathly origins, including today's scripture from the Gospel of Mark. Today we've read of a birthday party gone all wrong, or right, depending upon whose viewpoint you see the events through. John, who was called the baptizer even in his own day, had been imprisoned by King Herod, the nominal ruler of Galilee, because he had spoken truth to Herod's power. In regards to John, we must remember that John was not simply the one who baptized Jesus, but his ministry of preparation had resulted in him baptizing many hundreds or even thousands of Jewish people. As the first verses of Mark declare, he appeared in the wilderness proclaiming a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. And people were baptized by him in the River Jordan, confessing their sins. The Greek word metanoia has often been translated as repentance, like in today's scripture, but the verb actually means to change one's mind or to change one's character or attitude. And perhaps this is the better way to think of what John first called for and what Jesus then preached in regards to the kingdom of heaven. Repentance as simple contrition and sorriness, well, it really doesn't do it, does it? No, rather than simply feeling sorry for what we've done, we need to be more viscerally, more basically, look at changing why we've done those things. So you see that John's preaching and call for a change of mind or attitude to the Jewish people was the beginning of a renewal within Galilee and Judea. That renewal then grew and was enlarged with Jesus' preaching, teaching, and miracles, and then culminated in his death and resurrection. So you see, John was the first to preach for the people to turn from their old ways to a new. John started what became a movement that Jesus built upon with his preaching and acts of power, and ultimately with his death and resurrection to new life. But as we see, John did not survive the reactions of the powerful to this movement that called for a change. John was fearless in preaching to his Jewish brothers and sisters that they needed to change their minds, their attitudes, and their hearts to God and to God's way of doing things. He was so fearless that he spoke through the crowds directly to Herod the Tetrarch. He called for Herod to change his ways. Specifically, John preached against Herod taking his brother's wife as his own. This truth-telling did not allow John to stay free for long. Already in the 14th verse of Mark's Gospel, it is written that John was arrested by Herod for telling the truth. Then, though Herod was intrigued by and even a bit fearful of John, his wife Herodias simply wanted him dead and used Herod's offer to his stepdaughter Salome at the birthday party to get her wish. John's head served on a platter. It's a very interesting and powerful story that we've read this morning. But the real question for us, though, in the 21st century is, what do we learn from the story of John the Baptist? Yes, John spoke truth to power. And no, he did not claim for himself any accolades of praise, but rather he pointed to Jesus as the one whom would be all that we needed. As I pointed out, John began the call for a turning to a new way. But it was Jesus who not only showed us what the new way looked like, but then became the way himself for all who will believe. The greatest thing that John showed us was the importance of pointing to Jesus no matter what. Now, John had a great following. John had the ear of much of Judea and Galilee. The powerful were even listening to what he had to say, even requesting baptism for themselves. John could have made money. John could have acquired power. John could have even taken on himself the title of Messiah, and the people would have followed and believed. But he didn't. John stayed true to the God-given calling for his life. Right from the beginning, he knew that he was the one who was supposed to point the way to the Messiah, not to try and be him. We, in the same way, can do no other. Jesus loves us, forgives us, and graces us with salvation so that we may love him and share with others that he loves them too. We are called to be the great pointer-outers of Christ. You know, to point people to the new way of being, the new way of life, to open their eyes and hearts and minds that they may see Jesus. But the question is, how do we do that in our modern world? How do we point the way to Jesus when so many people do not even believe there's a God? Now, I think it's futile to argue or to debate, and to judge and condemn only fractures any possibility to truly relate person to person. So how do we point the way to Jesus to those whom don't want to see? Well, we love them. Yep, we're called to be the ones who need to give love, Jesus' love, to the world. We have to love the world through our actions and words. And that is the core of our calling as Christians. Love. Simple, hard love. I call it hard love because we're called to love in a new way, which is the way of Christ. We are called simply to try and emulate, to copy how Jesus loved. How did he do that? Well, it was to sit down with tax collectors, prostitutes, and sinners of all types, and eat with them. To then love them into relationship with Jesus by showing them that they were worth acceptance. They were worth being loved. People often do not want to listen to debate or to feel as if they're trying to be convinced of something. But over time, their hearts will listen and change when they feel the effects in their own lives of humble and caring godly love. It is then that they can come to understand within their own lives the power and grace that exists within the reality of Jesus. I know a man who came to believe in Jesus because of the love and acceptance that he felt within his group of friends over time, through the joys and sorrows of life. It didn't happen right away, and it didn't happen through debate or scare tactics or pushing. He came to believe in this new way, in this Jesus, because he felt the effects of Jesus' love in his life. His Christian friends stood by him in sickness, through the hardships of his marriage, and when he lost his job. They listened to him in his heartaches, continually prayed for him. You see, they accepted him as their friend, and they didn't let him go. In other words, they did the hard work of love, and he knew it. And because of their actions and words, he came to know Jesus. They had pointed the way again and again, hoping and praying and always trying to love. And the man saw, and now he believes and follows Jesus as his Lord. Let us point the way to Jesus and his love for the world by the ways that we speak and the ways that we act. Let them, our neighbors, our friends, our family, the world, let them know Jesus through and by our love. Amen.
ever bright enough after all. You are
Let us pray for the whole people of God in Christ Jesus and all people according to their need. Gracious God, John the Baptist pointed to you. He could have done many things, but he pointed to you. Lord, help us to follow his example and be the people who point to you. Help us to be people who live our lives in such a way that we show love and through our relationships with you and with others, they might see and be drawn to you. Gracious God, we lift up before you today all those who are in special need. And we pray today for all those who are suffering in body, mind, or spirit. We lift up to you today, especially Dale and Cora May. And we ask, Lord, that you'd be with all those who are still battling cancer. We pray for those, Lord, who are battling COVID around the world, and especially this new Delta variant. And we ask, Lord, that there may be an end to this pandemic. We're reminded of those who are still struggling economically and ask for your presence and support, that all might find equitable living. Gracious God, we give you thanks for our Saviors and for the ways in which you've worked through this church for 150 years. And we ask that you would bless our plans as we get ready to celebrate the 150th anniversary with a celebration. And we ask that you would bless the celebration on the 19th, and that you would help us find an opportunity to celebrate after so many things in this world in this last year have been a drag on our lives and on our feelings and on our willingness even or ability to celebrate. Gracious God, continue to be at work in our lives this week. Help us to see how we can be your heart, hands, and feet, that we can be those pointers to Christ, that we can exhibit love in our relationships, that we can find those places where we can do little deeds of kindness, where we can speak an encouraging word and uplift others in hope. Lord, you know the things that we need. We lay them before you now, asking in Jesus' name, who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. And for announcements, I have just one for us today. I want to remind everyone that on the 21st of July, that's a Wednesday, we'll be having a WOW service, worship on Wednesday. We'll have a meal at 6 o'clock, and the worship will start at 7. Receive the benediction. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Christ is our calling, in Christ's name.